Welcome, everyone. Thanks for coming. My name is Mollen Clyde, and I'm with the New Hampshire Coverts Project, and that's a wildlife volunteer program run by the University of New Hampshire Cooperative Extension. This is a Speaking for Wildlife program, and that's a project that brings wildlife presentations and nature walks to communities across New Hampshire. And in today's Speaking for Wildlife presentation, I'll be talking to you about the history of New Hampshire wildlife. And I'll talk for about 35 minutes or so, and there'll certainly be time for questions at the end. But if you have questions about the slides I'm showing, please feel free to raise your hand during the presentation, and I'll try to answer them then. To really understand the history of wildlife in New Hampshire, we have to look at two other things. And those are the history of how people have used the land in New Hampshire. So you can see those slides on the top about development and historical agriculture and broader scale agriculture, and also about how human attitudes towards wildlife have changed over time. So things like our approach to hunting and why we might take animals, how we appreciate wildlife or don't appreciate wildlife. And our hope is that by understanding the connection between wildlife and our history, we can all start to make better decisions about our land that help conserve wildlife for the future. Like any good historical story, we're going to start in the past and move forward to today. We'll start back in the 1600s, before Europeans had really started to settle in New Hampshire in significant numbers. To keep things relatively simple, in this talk, we've grouped time into centuries up until the 20th century. And at that point, we'll break the timeline into the first half of the 20th century and the second half. And that leads us up to today. At the end of the talk, I'll spend some time describing how the changes in New Hampshire's wildlife populations and in our landscape over time have affected different groups of wildlife, particularly those that are rare in the state today. So hopefully you'll leave the talk today with some ideas about how you can help conserve wildlife in New Hampshire. So let's get started. So we'll start our history about 350 years ago, back in the mid-1600s. To give you some context, at this point, Europeans have arrived in New England and the fur trade is underway, but very little of the interior of New Hampshire has been settled. So we would have had European settlers on the coast and perhaps up some of the major rivers. But the fact was the state was about 95% forested at this time. And to give you an idea of what those forests might have looked like, let's think about the types of disturbance that would have occurred on the landscape at this time. And the slide that you see right now is an example from the Harvard University's Harvard Forest Dioramas, which are located down in Petersham, Massachusetts. And these are little 3D models that are a reconstruction of what the forests might have looked like over time from the settlement, European settlement, up until today. They're really interesting if you ever have a chance to go see them. But when you see slides like this, that's what they are. They're not actual forests. They're 3D models. So can anybody think of an example of natural events that would have been happening in the forests of the 1600s that would have created change and shaped the structure of these forests? So great. Examples of large-scale disturbances that would have been happening in the forests back in the 1600s, they still happen today. Things like hurricanes or huge windstorms, ice storms, we've seen examples of that in the recent decades here in New Hampshire. The tornado that happened a couple of years ago, these made a really large-scale impact on the forest, and they're setting back the trees to young forest in huge patches. But at the same time, there's smaller scale disturbances that are also important. So single trees would fall here and there due to insects or just getting old or small windstorms. And these create small gaps in the canopy throughout the forest. And in these small gaps, you have young trees that can take advantage of the sunlight and begin to grow. So it's not just big old trees in these old forests. There are also large patches of young trees and individually small trees growing up under the canopy of the older trees. We also can't underestimate the impact that beavers would have had on the landscape. Beavers were incredibly abundant. We know that from historical records. And they had a big impact on the land by periodically flooding huge areas, particularly in flat landscapes. One dam can flood hundreds of acres. And this would mean that as dams got abandoned, that you'd have big swaths of young forest coming up along waterways. But it wasn't just natural disturbance that had an effect on the landscape. We're quite sure that humans also had an impact on the landscape during the 1600s and certainly for many centuries before that time. Native Americans were clearing the land, at least on a small scale, for agriculture, especially in areas that had rich, fertile soil, so they chose their sites carefully, and those would have been certainly along the Connecticut River Valley, but also likely in the Great Bay area, where you would have some estuary areas that have good soils, but are also clear of forest, and would have been easy to plant as agricultural sites. The Native Americans were also burning the understory of the forest to improve hunting, so they'd be able to see their prey more easily without a dense understory of the forest, but also they'd be able to move more easily under a cleared forest. So fire we can really consider as another disturbance that affected the landscape. It's interesting to think about fire as a natural disturbance as well. We don't think of New England as a place that has a lot of forest fires, but they were occasionally part of the landscape, and some of our forests that are still here in New Hampshire are adapted to fire. So those would be our pitch pine and pine barren sites up in the Ossipee area and around Concord. But essentially fire was very rare in other parts of the state, maybe also on mountaintops that would get lightning strikes. But other than that, fire wasn't really a big component except those that were set by Native Americans. With all the natural and human disturbances happening on the land, you can begin to imagine what the forest might have looked like back in the 1600s. It would have been a patchwork of old and young forest. It would have been dotted with a lot of wetlands and abandoned beaver meadows. And it basically would have been a pretty diverse forest. And you can look at this slide and sort of see that it's not all the dense primeval forests that we might romantically imagine New England have looked like for early settlers. It really was a patchwork and a mosaic of different aged trees and openings and wetlands that were shaped by some of the forces that we mentioned. So what would have wildlife looked like during this time? Well, basically, it was very abundant, and there are many historical records talking about how strikingly abundant so many species were. So we have pretty good records of that, particularly the species that were hunted and would have been of interest to early settlers, and they would have made note of it. So deer, certainly moose were everywhere, turkey, woodcock, and passenger pigeons were all plentiful at this time. Wolf, bobcat, lynx, even cougar were all common. And as I mentioned earlier, beaver were incredibly common, but also muskrats occurred in almost every waterway in the state. So now let's think about human attitudes towards wildlife at this time. How do you think people viewed wildlife? Well, the slide here gives you an idea. People are using wildlife as a resource, and it was valuable to them, mostly because wildlife was a source of food, certainly for both Europeans and Native Americans. But fur was used as a currency by, again, both Native Americans and Europeans. The furs would be used to trade for useful items, particularly by Native Americans to Europeans, to get some of those trade goods. But also Europeans were trapping fur bearers and selling the furs that would end up being made into hats. Back in Europe, you can see this is a beaver pelt top hat, and they were all the rage back at this time. And so beaver particularly had a really high value. At the same time, Native Americans were also using wildlife to make their clothing and their shelter and lots of tools. So hopefully that paints a pretty clear picture of what the forests and the wildlife diversity looked like in the 1600s, before and during the early part of European settlement of New Hampshire. But let's move on now to the next century. So this is between 1700 and 1800. And during this time, we start to see the expansion of settlements into the interior of New Hampshire. There's a dramatic increase in the clearing of land for both agriculture and pasture land. And as you can imagine, if you've ever noticed the amount of rocks around here, the going was really tough for these early farmers. Wild game was still really important as a food source, and this is increasingly important as the human population grows. They need more food to feed more people. But keep in mind that there are no hunting seasons during this time. There are no limits on what any one person can take, so any species is fair game at any time of the year. As the shift towards agriculture starts in the 1700s, we also see a shift in attitudes towards wildlife. Game species are still valuable as a source of food, so game species being things like turkey and deer and woodcock, grouse. But other wildlife are starting to be recognized as a nuisance and a problem. So raccoons, bears, porcupine can all do damage to crops. Your hen house is threatened by things like fox and marten and skunks. And your livestock are threatened by things like wolves and bobcats, lynx, cougar. And farmers start to take these species and kill them indiscriminately. By this time, the fur trade is essentially over in New England. They've got competition from Canadian markets, and there's been a huge decrease in the beaver population due to overtrapping in the previous century. So that's already happening in the early part of the 1700s. So there's a real shift in both land use and human attitudes towards wildlife, and this continues on through the next century and the 1800s. By 1830, we've reached the peak of agriculture in New Hampshire, with approximately 60 to 80% of the state cleared for crop or pasture lands. And this I find incredibly hard to imagine when I look at New Hampshire today, but this slide and many old paintings, and certainly the evidence of the stone walls that are running through deep forest in New Hampshire, all help paint a picture of what it must have been like in the 1800s, early 1800s, of this incredibly agricultural landscape that's so different from the way it is today, and certainly different from the 95% forested landscape that early settlers saw when they first arrived. Here's a great early photograph from the Library of Congress, and it's from Cruft's Ledge, which is up in Bethlehem, New Hampshire, which is solid forest now. This is a huge change in the landscape. New Hampshire goes from being mostly forest to being mostly open. During this time, we begin to see some species of wildlife that may not have occurred here before. For example, species like grassland birds appear to have come eastward into New Hampshire from the Midwest and the prairie states when the forests were cleared. And grassland birds, as their name suggests, make their nests in grass. So the newly created farmland of the 1700s and 1800s in New Hampshire looked pretty attractive to them. These are, in the slide, you can see three examples of grassland birds, and they're all found in New Hampshire still today, but are unlikely to have been here before the farming period in New Hampshire. So we have bobolinks on the left, eastern meadowlarks in the middle, and upland sandpipers on the right. An interesting thing about grassland birds is that different species require different sizes of grasslands to build their nests. And in fact, they will not build their nests if the area of opening or that grassy patch is not big enough. And bobolinks don't require a huge area, but they won't nest in grasslands that are smaller than 5 acres, which is still pretty big. Eastern meadowlarks require 15 acres or larger of fields. And upland sandpipers require grasslands that are bigger than 100 acres in size. So you can imagine that the scale of some of the land clearing in New Hampshire if upland sandpipers begin to make a home here in New Hampshire during this time. So while things were looking pretty good for grassland birds during this time, they weren't looking so great for a lot of other wildlife species. The 1800s is also the height of market hunting, where wildlife was hunted to sell for profit, not just for personal consumption or to feed your family. And keep in mind that there are still no hunting seasons or bag limits, and this led to a large decrease in species like moose, deer, turkey, grouse, all those game species that people are eating. The photo on the left is of harvested ducks, and on the right is a picture of a punt gun, which was mounted on a little boat, and it would shoot up to 5 pounds of metal. And it would be in a scattershot pattern, and this shot would kill a whole flight of ducks or a whole flock of geese as they rested in the water or just as they were flying off. And this was incredibly lethal to flocks of birds, as several boats would often be working together and take out huge numbers of animals. The peak of land clearing, so that would be 1830, also marked the end of large-scale agriculture in New Hampshire. The flat, treeless prairie out in the Midwest with rich soils and rock-free landscape really was a big improvement over New England's landscape for farming. So people abandoned their New Hampshire farms, they went west, or they went into the cities for paid work. So all those Manchester mills were part of that same change in society. And that's a trend that continued for well over a century. And the abandoned fields and farms quickly began reverting to young forest. As anyone knows around here who's tried to keep a field open in New Hampshire, that our landscape really wants to be trees. And it only takes 1 or 2 years of not mowing your backyard and you'll get a young forest started. So this brings us to the beginning of the 20th century. What did the landscape look like now? Well, as forests were maturing, land clearing was still happening, but this time it was happening through forestry. So it wasn't just farmers clearing them for fields, but they were clearing the forest for the value of the trees. Wood was essential for making boxes and shipping crates that were part of that manufacturing economy, and this is before the invention of cardboard, so we needed to make things out of wood. Big things begin to change for wildlife as well during the 20th century. By 1900, the passenger pigeon is gone. It's extinct from the entire planet. Wolves, cougar, turkey, beaver, they're all extirpated from the state. And extirpated means simply that they no longer exist in New Hampshire, but they still exist in other places or other states. Woodcock numbers are so low by 1900, they're expected to become extinct. And moose, deer, grouse, bobcat, marten, fisher are all at their lowest numbers ever. And at this point, to give you a sense of it, there are believed to be only about 50 moose in New Hampshire. So the situation sounds pretty dire around the turn of the century. But these extreme drops in wildlife population also helped spur the foundation of a conservation ethic. Unregulated hunting was clearly not sustainable. People realized that wildlife populations were finite now that we'd lost a few species in the state, as particularly some of those species that were game species that people had sort of counted on both for food or for sport. So New Hampshire Fish and Game had been established in 1865, but it really wasn't until the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century that they took an active role in establishing hunting seasons and creating bag limits, requiring hunting licenses, and really enforcing hunting regulation. Also at this time, there started to be the creation of wildlife refuges, which are protecting land for the express purpose of protecting wildlife. So usually big, extensive wetlands and places where ducks or other game species would be plentiful. Fueled by this new conservation ethic, Congress passed the Federal Aid in Wildlife Restoration Act in 1937, and this is commonly called the Pittman-Robertson Act. And the Pittman-Robertson Act earmarked a 10% tax on ammunition and firearms used for sport hunting, and this money was to be distributed to individual states for wildlife restoration. And the act has been really important in the recovery of wildlife habitat and species throughout the last 70 years and still plays a really important role in funding wildlife habitat management, species conservation, land acquisition, scientific research, and hunting education here in New Hampshire. This new conservation ethic certainly had a positive impact on wildlife populations during the 20th century. But it was really the continued reversion of farmland back to forest and the resulting incredible abundance of young forest across the state that allowed much of our wildlife species to begin to recover during the first half of the century. Young forests are particularly important to wildlife because they provide dense, thicket-like growth that's ideal habitat and cover for species like ruffed grouse, woodcock, moose, deer, and New England cottontail rabbits, among many other species. As these wildlife populations begin to increase in the early part of the 20th century, we even start to see new species coming into the state. The coyote was first seen in New Hampshire in 1944. And they most likely came to New Hampshire because of the increase in prey, such as rabbits and ruffed grouse, and also the lack of competing predators, since there are no longer any wolves or cougars in the state. So this brings us to the second half of the 20th century. So I don't know if any of you have been in New Hampshire for a long time, but if you have, you've likely noticed how quickly a field can become a shrubby tangle of young forest, and how that young forest matures faster than you might expect. So today, about 83% of New Hampshire is forested, and we're the second most forested state in the country behind Maine. With an increase in the amount of mature forest here in New Hampshire, we're certainly seeing an increase in the wildlife species associated with those mature forests. Wild turkey, for example, were successfully reintroduced in New Hampshire in 1975 when New Hampshire Fish and Game released 25 turkeys into the wild. And now we have about 30,000 turkeys in New Hampshire, all from those early reintroductions. This reintroduction of turkeys is a perfect example of how the Pittman-Robertson Act has been used successfully here in New Hampshire. In the latter part of the 20th century, deer are so abundant that the population has to be kept in check with regulated hunting. Moose and bobcats can be found in every part of the state. And back in 2008, a bobcat was spotted in the seacoast area, and now that's becoming not even that unusual. And today, just like at the beginning of European settlement, beaver are found in nearly every watercourse in the state. But our forests today are not exactly like the forests that were here before European settlers arrived. Regardless of how diverse today's forest might look, most are between 70 and 100 years old. They're all about the same age, and they grew up during the first half of the 20th century after the period of turn-of-the-century land clearing. We've also reduced some of the natural disturbances on the land. For example, we prevent flooding by our use of dams, and we suppress forest fires. So today's forests are not nearly as old, they're not as diverse or really as patchy as they might have been, say, 400 years ago when European settlers were first arriving in New Hampshire. Today's forests are also different because they're fragmented or they're broken up by human settlement, both in cities and in suburban and scattered development across the state. And this development is probably the biggest threat to wildlife today in New Hampshire. So why do you think that is? What sets development apart from other impacts on the land like natural disturbance or farming? The answer really is that human development is much more permanent. Much of the impact we've had on the landscape in the past, like farming and forestry and hunting, has been pretty temporary. So even if the landscape changed dramatically, it's been able to recover. But as development continues, it'll become increasingly important to identify areas that are particularly valuable to wildlife and to work to conserve them. So to this end, wildlife biologists, state New Hampshire Fish and Game staff, nonprofit organizations, and the University of New Hampshire Cooperative Extension, many other groups, have been working to raise awareness about wildlife species and habitat that are rare in New Hampshire. And in our state, this means reaching out to the 84,000 private landowners in our state. Because did you know that over 80% of the land in New Hampshire is privately owned? We depend on these private landowners to provide habitat and also clean water, recreational opportunities, and other values that all of us can enjoy. If we want to have an impact on wildlife habitat, we have to talk to the people that own the land. One of the greatest wildlife concerns in New Hampshire today is the fact that while wildlife that use mature forests are thriving, shrubland and open field habitats are some of the most rare habitats we have in the state. And as a result, wildlife species that require these open habitats are declining. For example, grassland birds, we talked about grassland birds earlier, the populations of these birds are declining. At this point, there's only one known nesting location of upland sandpipers in the state. Species like northern leopard frogs and smooth green snakes, both of these species are associated with grassy fields and wet meadows, they're now listed as species of conservation concern, which means that Fish and Game is sort of watching their populations to try and see if they're in danger of becoming requiring listing on the threatened and endangered species list. Northern harrier, which is a hawk that hunts over grasslands, and New England cottontail rabbits, which require shrubby thickets, are both listed as state endangered species now. And there have been marked declines in populations of species like American kestrel and woodcock and many other bird species that use fields and shrublands. So a lot of the wildlife habitat management work that goes on today is geared specifically towards creating and maintaining grasslands and shrubby thickets to help keep these species on the landscape in New Hampshire. And there are many other examples of habitats and species that deserve special attention in New Hampshire. For example, lowland spruce fir forests and peatlands, vernal pools, grasslands. So a series of new brochures that are aimed at private landowners is now available from UNH Cooperative Extension and through New Hampshire Fish and Game. And this is called the Habitat Stewardship Series, and I have copies available for those of you who might be interested. And this series is aimed at helping anyone identify important habitats on their property. And the brochures include pictures of key wildlife species, as well as information on what landowners can do to help these species, such as land management, conservation practices, and where to report wildlife sightings, among lots of other ideas. So these stewardship brochures are the result of research that was compiled in something called the New Hampshire Wildlife Action Plan. And the Wildlife Action Plan was completed in 2006, and it identifies a couple of things. It identified 123 species and 27 habitats that are considered to be in greatest need of conservation. It also mapped out the 27 habitat types across the state, which is a huge undertaking, but it resulted in some very interesting maps that are being used by folks all across the state as conservation tools. And that's really what the Wildlife Action Plan is. It's a tool for the state, for communities, and even for landowners. And many groups cooperated to create the plan and are now really invested in working to implement it. So it's kind of interesting to check out those habitat maps. I've brought one with me today. There's one posted in the back of the room, and I think you might find it interesting to see what kind of habitats are on this map for the town where this talk is taking place. So back in the back of the room, you can check that out. So how can you learn more about wildlife today? Well, I would suggest that you start with what you already know. And a great way to get started is to explore your own property or your local town forest or conservation land. Learning about the history of the specific piece of land can tell you a lot about what wildlife has inhabited the area in the past and what species might be there now. So you can take an inventory of your land or your local town property. You can use the Landowner's Guide to Inventorying and Monitoring Wildlife in New Hampshire to help you. And it'll help you identify what habitats and species you have in your area. I have a copy with me here today, but you can also order your own copy from Cooperative Extension, or you can access it for free online. Another thing you can do is to learn to recognize species and habitats using the habitat stewardship brochures as a guide. If you know neighbors who own land with some of these habitat types, you can share the materials with them. And if you're a landowner yourself, you can contact Cooperative Extension and try and have a county forester come out for a free site visit to help you learn more about your property. There are some really great resources out there to help you get involved in wildlife conservation in New Hampshire. One thing you can do is you can sign up on the sign-up sheet that I brought here for an e-newsletter that's called Taking Action for Wildlife. And you can learn on the e-newsletter, you'll get an email that tells you about upcoming events, new research, stories about landowners and what kind of things they're doing to help wildlife in New Hampshire, and new programs and workshops that are related to wildlife and wildlife habitat conservation in the state. UNH Cooperative Extension also hosts a lot of workshops on wildlife and forestry. And if you fill out the questionnaire that I brought today, be sure to provide your contact information so you can hear about similar workshops in this area. Two good websites to consult are newhampshirewoods.org, so nhwoods.org, which is UNH Cooperative Extension's forestry and wildlife website. You can learn about those workshops, about habitats, and particularly about land stewardship. You can access the inventorying and monitoring wildlife on your land and the habitat stewardship brochures you can download for free on that website. Also, wildnewhampshire.com, which is wildnh.com, is New Hampshire Fish and Game's website. And here you can learn a lot about species, and as well as new research and conservation, and as well about the Wildlife Action Plan. I also brought lots of handouts and brochures that you're welcome to look at before you go home. So that's the end of my presentation. Before I take any questions, I'd like to thank the organizations who sponsor the Speaking for Wildlife project. And those are the New Hampshire Charitable Foundation and the Davis Conservation Foundation for the grants that help support Speaking for Wildlife, UNH Cooperative Extension for supporting the volunteer program that's the underpinnings of this project, and the New Hampshire Fish and Game for their support of New Hampshire UNH Cooperative Extension and for the wildlife research that goes into this presentation. So thanks for listening. Any questions?